to South Africa. This is almost like another home for you, right?
I don't know what's about South Africa, but I'm always happy when I come here. So I feel more like home here.
Tell us about some of your fondest memories. And you can take us back to maybe the first time you came to South Africa. We're all friends here. Yeah? Open up.
I think the first time I came here, I was about 16.
Mm-hmm.
We had this Meridian Under 17 tournament in Cape Town. And I think I fell in love with this country. And every time I've been here, even coming to play against South Africa, we always beat them, but you know, we're still brothers, you know. So yeah, I'm always happy to come here.
Why was it such an easy transition or an easy decision to make to be a part of this wonderful Budweiser campaign? I mean, you are viewed by many as Africa's finest exports. You've lived most of your moments that the footballing fans.
Stop making me blush.
Truth only. And you've lived out most of the moments that the footballing fans are now looking forward to experiencing in LaLiga and, of course, the Premier League. While growing up in Ghana, did you ever have that vision or that aspiration to play in the Prem?
Well, first of all, I would say a big thanks to Budweiser for, you know, choosing me as one of their kings, their ambassador. I think the first time I'm feeling like a king. So, yeah, it's so good. And, growing up as a child, what we used to watch on TV was the Premier League. So it was always my dream to, you know, to play in the Premier League. And, you know, as they say, sometimes dreams come true. So, yeah.
I know one thing that you've said before is that as South Africans, we have this natural attraction to football, to the beautiful game. And you played it in the streets without any boots on, with whatever it is that, whatever materials we could gather to make that ball. And that's something that you did as well when you were growing up in Ghana.
Yeah, obviously. I mean, I've been here many times and I see the love they have for football. And it's the same in when you go to the West. I mean, Ghana is a big football fans as well. And as you said, we, you know, when we're a kid, any little round thing, you know, we turn into a football, and that's what we used to do. And you know, as they say, the worst come from the best come from the worst. So, yeah, you know, with those you know, little balls, you know, makes us the better players we are today.
What I also love about your story and your background is that you know more than anyone else that they're different kings in our lives. For you, your mother, you grew up in a family with a lot of women around you, your sisters,
yes.
Your mother. Those
That's
are your kids.
I always like women sitting there.
At what stage in your life did you realize that you could take a shot, you could seize that moment and become a seasoned footballer?
I think when I was about 15, because I was in school at that time and I had a call to join the National Under 17 side, and I didn't want to go at the beginning, so I stayed home for like another month, and thank God my mom, you know, managed to convince me to go, and I took that shot because I have to drop out from school, you know, and have to go into football. But you know, having my mom's support kind of helped, and that's what I did. And thanks to God, I managed to live up to my dream.
That was a very important time in your life as well. Tell us a little bit about how you realized that you're multi-talented, because your role on the pitch was more up front, right? And then you had to change into that midfield position. Tell us about that.
I know when you're a kid, you always want to score.
Yeah. Yeah.
So yeah. I've always loved football, you know, and well, apparently my dad used to play football, but that's what he says, but I never saw him playing. And as a little boy, you know, my mom always buy me football, and she would always, you know, anytime she goes to the market, she would bring back football, and I would just go out and, you know, enjoy with my friends. And you know, back then when you're good, you can tell, you know, because you are way ahead of the others. And as I was growing, I kept, you know, going back and back, and I was actually a center back when I was about 16, 17. So that's where, like, I see the game, you know, everything is in front of me and I can read it very well. And then when I was in France, I moved to become a midfielder, you know, and I'm stuck there now.
That's where you really thrived. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about that move from Lyon to Chelsea. I mean, it made headlines. Big, big move. Club record for the Blues at the time. What was that feeling like when you knew that this deal was about to happen? Actually, before that, coming to the Premier League, there was a team, though, that you wanted to play for. It's all right, you're Chelsea through and through, but please tell everyone the team that you aspired to play for and almost did, actually.
Well, as a child growing up back in Ghana, I used to be a big Man United fan, you know, and I've always wanted to play for Man United, and I actually got a chance to play for them, but lack of work permit didn't allow me to sign for them, so I moved on to France, and everything happens from there afterwards. And when it was one afternoon, we were having a barbecue, we had a very tough training session in the morning, and you know, Maluda decided to have a barbecue, so we all went, and he had a call, and it was Drogba, you know. Drogba was asking him, is Michael around? And because Jose wanted to speak to him, and he said, Michael is right beside me, so you can talk to him yourself. So yeah, he passed on the phone to me, and I spoke to Drogba briefly, and afterwards I started talking to Mourinho, and he kind of made it clear that he wanted me at Chelsea, and you know, I fit in very well with the system he want to play, and I said, okay, then let's get into business. But it was not an easy transfer. It was very difficult, and at one point I have to say I'm not going to train, you know, because I wanted this move to go through. But as a professional, I still have to, you know, be professional and do my work.
You said the transition from France and then to the Premier League, toughest league in the world. Tell us about that and what made it easier for you. I know Mourinho, of course, playing such an important and key role in your career.
Well, I won't say it was easy because I already knew about the Premier League, you know, what we call it, Premiership at that time. And so I already knew the physical aspect of the game, and it kind of goes to, you know, kind of fit into the way I play as well. So it was a bit easy for me to get into it and you know, start training with my teammate and get into business, you know, because I remember Drogba said, be careful of this boy, you know, when he comes, because he's not one of those soft ones. So they kind of knew the player they are, you know, they're gonna be training with and stuff like that. So
you've had a lot of highlights in your career, from the Premier League, La Liga. Can you tell us one of the moments when you felt like a king?
Well, actually, this morning when I came here, I wake up like a king.
Yeah?
Yeah. No, I mean, I've had some great times, and I would say winning the Premier League for the first time was a big highlight for me, and also, you know, as a child, I wanted to be a footballer, and I got a chance to start off in France. So I would say that kind of gave me the step ahead and to become a professional footballer.
You know, what's special about this Be a King campaign is that we're going to be having ordinary football fans, primarily from the African continent, getting a moment to really see some of their kings in the Premier League, in La Liga, some of their kings in action, seeing them live as well. How do you think that this will make a difference? How will it inspire and uplift football fans in Africa?
Well, I think it's a big thing that Budweiser is doing for the football fans, you know. And, you know, Africa, we love football, and they are doing everything to get the fans close to their heroes, I may say, and to get more time to talk to them, interact with them. So yeah, it's a It's a big thing, and I'm honored to be, you know, one of the ambassadors, the kings. Mm-hmm. They made me a king to this. It was all good. So yeah, it's good thing, and I think it's going to inspire the young ones as well to, you know, to work hard, and hopefully they can achieve their dreams, because dreams come true sometimes.
We love the fact that this campaign is also focusing on the lifestyle of the footballers. Tell us about yours. You're still playing. You're in Azerbaijan. On and off the pitch, let's talk. Well, one thing we know you love is music, because you've always got your headphones on. Tell us about the music that you love. Some of your favorite artists as well.
That's an easy one. Yeah. I mean, I love my music, so most of the time I have my headphones on, and mostly I'm listening to reggae. I'm a big fan of reggae music, and I love Lucky the Man, you know. Pay my respect to him. But yeah, he's one of my, you know, my biggest reggae artists, and mostly every morning I have to, you know, play at least two or three tracks of him. And
to what is one of your favorite tracks?
I love The Prisoner. Okay. I love the other one, what's it called?
You can say
there's
it.
So many. There's okay. So many. I'm trying to think. Romeo and Juliet.
Okay.
And I love The Tax Man. You know. We don't know where our money goes, but okay. They always take it from us. Yeah.
What's the difference in terms of the lifestyle in England or in the UK and in Spain?
Well, I mean,
and which do you prefer?
I mean, they are both big cities, isn't it? And I mean, when it comes to my lifestyle, I'm quite very simple. I just go to my training, my games, and just come home and chill with my music and my beer, if I may say.
Yeah.
And I would say living in England is I'll go for England, because that's where I spend most of my years playing there, and well, my family is there, my kids are there, and well, I had the chance to go to Madrid, which was one of the biggest cities, and I kind of loved it. I loved it because it's Madrid. Everyone want to visit Madrid, and playing for Real Madrid is a big honor. And but when it comes to my lifestyle, I don't really do much. Just train, eat, sleep,
music, listen to music. KG and Dugel were complaining about the food in England. They said horrible.
They are spoiled.
Yeah? They're spoiled?
They are spoiled. No, but I mean, in England, England is like a kind of like second home, you know, because I always get my Africa, my Ghana food there. So for me, the food there was not bad, because I get my Africa,
you made a
my
plan.
Ghana food.
Yeah.
They were eating the wrong food, fish and chips. I was eating my jollof and banku.
Michael, it's such an honor to have you here, and we're very, very proud to have you as one of the kings. Keep doing the wonderful work that you are.
Thank you very much, and I'm honored to be here as well.
Round of applause. Yeah, round of applause, ladies and gentlemen.